Hey, good morning, Chapel family. Great to see you today. Thank you so much for the birthday wishes. It means a lot to me. Feeling very blessed. Also, I've just been feeling this morning just the weight of some of the brokenness in our world, and especially what's happening, if you follow the news at all, in Israel and Gaza. So it actually fits in with everything we're talking today. So I just wanted to start with a prayer for peace in our world. Would you join me with that? Lord, as we sit here in this really peaceful place with a beautiful spring day outside, we want to try to put ourselves just for a minute in the shoes of people who are in Israel right now with rockets landing around them, people in Gaza, Lord, with bombs falling on buildings. And Lord, help us just to feel a little bit of the weight of that and the fear of that. And help us, Lord, on behalf of them to just turn our eyes upward and recognize that peace comes from you. Lord, that as humans in our natural thinking, we're just a mess. And so God, we pray for peace. I pray that instead of anger and a cycle of revenge and payback and mistrust, that there will be forgiveness, that there will be patience, that there will be goodwill extended. And God, we know that's a huge ask. But we just pray for that, Lord. We pray for peace in the name of Jesus Christ. And I pray, Lord, that we will be peacemakers in whatever realm you call us to, Lord. And that you will today, Lord, through your Holy Spirit, through your word, Lord, that you would just make that peacemaking power stronger in us so that we can go out in the world and we can be that catalyst, however you call us to do that. Lord, open up our hearts today. Open up our minds to your Holy Spirit, to your word. Change us, Lord, from being here today. We give you this time. In Jesus' name, amen. So I just wanted to mention to you one little way that the chapel is trying to be catalysts for peace in our culture, especially in some of the racial division that exists in our country. We just started the second round of a small group called Be the Bridge, which is based on a popular book by Latasha Morrison called Be the Bridge. But it's really built on the premise that the key to really reconciling as people, maybe whose skin color is different, that power doesn't primarily come from changing laws or changing policies, but it comes from changed hearts through the gospel. And so this group is about that. It's actually led by two mixed ethnicity couples that are right here from the chapel. And I just wanted to let you know about it because it's very timely. So Thursday evenings, this is one of the groups that meets outside right here in the chapel campus, right over where our Christmas village was. They meet outside on Thursday evenings, and so if you have a kind of a heartbeat for that kind of ministry, which I hope a lot of you do, this group would be a great option for you. So I encourage you to check it out. You can find it on the website. You can also just email smallgroups@thechapel.org and tell them, hey, I'm interested in that Be the Bridge group, and they'll let you know more about that. So we are taking this spring to walk through one of the books in the New Testament, Paul's letter to the Philippians, which was written by Paul when he was sitting in a Roman prison cell. So if you were to look at things from the outside, you would look at Paul and say, this is a guy who's got zero freedom. But as soon as you start reading the letter, you realize, wait a minute, this is actually a free person, that there is a spaciousness and a largeness and a fierce freedom in Paul's soul that you can't miss. And it's so significant for us because it means that whatever kind of prisons we might be struggling with in life, whether they're, you know, some kind of physical problem we have or a financial debt prison or a really tough marriage or whatever it is, Paul is living proof that it's actually possible to live in interior, inner freedom, even when on the outside things can be kind of a mess. That's a life-changing concept. I mean, if we really got that, it would just radically change the way we went through life. And so today, Paul's going to show us that no matter what might be going on around us, we are free to have peace. And what a precious, priceless thing inner peace is, isn't it? And just to make sure we understand what that means, there's a verse in this passage that tells us what the opposite of peace is. In Philippians 4:6, it says, do not be anxious about anything. So I'd say the opposite of peace is anxiety. So, okay, what's anxiety? Let me give you a basic dictionary definition. Anxiety is a feeling, try to think about this in your own life, a feeling of worry, nervousness, or unease, typically about an imminent event or something with an uncertain outcome. That's what it means to have anxiety, this feeling of worry, nervousness, or unease. Anybody felt any of that recently? Over these past 14 months or so? Yeah. Last week I was talking to a friend who's a licensed therapist, and she said the life issue that she's seeing more often than any reason that people are coming to see her as a therapist is the uncertainty of the world. Things that in the past were pretty predictable, how they would turn out, there's so much uncertainty now, and all that uncertainty is just breeding this anxiety in people's lives. So feeling worry, nervousness, unease, the pandemic has given us a whole extra layer of things to feel anxious about, right? But also let's be careful not to blame everything on the pandemic. It's an easy scapegoat sometimes. Because the anxiety level in our country was rising way before anybody heard of Dr. Fauci or masks. It had been happening already. Just one example, in the October 2016 edition of Time magazine, they ran an article called Teen Depression and Anxiety, Why the Kids Are Not All Right. One teenager who was interviewed said this, quote, "We're the first generation that cannot escape our problems at all. We're all like little volcanoes. We're getting this constant pressure from our phones, from our relationships, from the way things are today." That's really sad, isn't it? And everybody knows, it's not just teenagers, right? There's big volcanoes out there too. If you're having a hard time sleeping, it's likely because of anxiety. If you're finding yourself drinking more than you used to, and we've all probably heard the statistics of alcohol sales spiking over the last year or so, it's probably because of anxiety. If you find yourself frequently angry at all the idiots out there who don't view things the right way like you do, that's probably because of anxiety. It's just all around us. Did you know that if you read on a Kindle, you know, a Kindle e-reader, did you know that Amazon keeps track of, like if you highlight stuff while you read, you know Amazon keeps track of all that? I know it's kind of creepy, right? But that's not why I bring it up today. They recently came out with the most highlighted part, the most highlighted verses in the Bible for people who read their Bible on the Kindle. What do you think the most highlighted verse in the Bible is? I would have guessed like John 3:16 maybe. Maybe the 23rd Psalm, right? The Lord is my shepherd. Maybe the Lord's Prayer, something like that. None of those won. The most highlighted passage on the Kindle Bible is Philippians 4, 6, and 7, which is the heart of the passage that we're going to look at today, which is all about anxiety and peace. Guys, this is a big deal. That's me holding my Kindle, by the way. This is a big deal, and I have a feeling it's kind of a big deal in your life as well. So let's read the passage, Philippians 4, verses 4 through 9. I invite everyone here to hear the word of God. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. This is the word of the Lord. So I'm feeling a little crazy today. Maybe it's a birthday thing. Instead of 3 points, I'm going with 5 today, right? So, yep, you heard me right, 5 points. I hope you've got a couple hours, you know, we're gonna be here a while. No, actually 5 points because there are, I count 5 different commands in this passage. And if you think about what a command is, when you come across a command in scripture, you have the choice whether to follow that command or not. And that sounds kind of obvious, but it's really important on this topic, especially because sometimes when anxiety is rising and it feels like it's taking control, you feel like you don't have any choices. Like life's just happening to you and you're just a passive victim of what's going on. It's not true. One of the things that became so clear to me as I was preparing this message is the most important choices in life are always available to us. You might have some choices taken away, restricted, prisons. The most things that really count the most, those choices are always open to us. And so those are what we're going to be looking at today. Here's the first one. Choose joy. Choose joy. Verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Doesn't it almost seem weird to command someone to be joyful? Like, you will be happy now, right? On a count of three, if you don't smile, right? But the only reason that seems so strange to us is that we're so used to thinking of joy as a feeling that happens to us. You can't command somebody to feel something, right? It's like, sorry, can't feel that way. But joy is not primarily a feeling. We're so used to also thinking that joy comes as a result of things in our life going well, but that's not how the Bible sees it. Paul the Apostle was a joyful person because it seems like he learned to anchor his joy in something deeper that doesn't change. If you think about the circumstances of Paul's life, they were chaotic. They changed all the time. And Paul found a source of joy that actually didn't change. A few years ago, Rick Warren, the pastor and author of The Purpose-Driven Life and lots of other stuff, experienced a horrific tragedy. 27-year-old son committed suicide. I can't imagine a life event that would cause more sadness and maybe anger and grief and anxiety, right? So, Thanksgiving of that year, Time magazine asked several public figures what they were thankful for. And I just want to read you what Rick Warren had to say. This year became the worst year of my life when my youngest son, who had struggled since childhood with mental illness, took his own life. How am I supposed to be thankful? God doesn't expect me to be thankful for all circumstances, but rather in all circumstances. There's a huge difference. The first attitude is masochism. The second shows maturity. I'm thankful that God sees all I go through. He cares. He grieves with me. I'm thankful that even though I don't know all the answers, God does. I'm thankful that God can bring good even out of the bad in my life when I give him the pieces. It's his specialty. God loves to turn crucifixions into resurrections and then benefit the whole world. Because I don't have to tell you this. Life can be just brutal. It can. And so if you have this sort of formula in your mind that I will be joyful when things are going well, like, okay, my job is going well today. Nobody fought in my family, at least today, and I don't have a migraine today. Okay, I can be joyful. If that's the way you do joy, you're setting yourself up for a collapse. You are just setting yourself up for disaster. But if you root your joy, and it's a process to learn this, right? But if you root your joy in something deeper, it's like drilling down beneath the surface of the earth till you find a well, fresh water that comes up. Then you might have droughts, you might have all kinds of stuff going on the surface, but that water of life just keeps on giving joy. And it doesn't mean that you're always laughing, you're always smiling. That's not what I mean by joy. You can be joyful through tears. That's actually possible. And it's what I appreciate so much about people like Rick Warren, and actually like Tony Dungy, another guy I admire who's a former NFL coach whose teenage son took his life when I think he was 17 or 18, because they grieved and they mourned, they showed healthy emotions, they stepped away from their work for a while. I mean, it shook them, obviously, but the anxiety did not eat them alive, because their joy was anchored in something deeper. Here's what I'm saying. By God's grace, we can choose that kind of joy. Here's the second choice we can make. Choose gentleness. Verse 5 says, let your gentleness be evident to all. That Greek word for gentleness was a word that was normally used when you would expect someone to strike back or take revenge because they were unjustly treated, but instead they respond with restraint. So it's a surprising kind of response. Gentleness when you would expect anger and aggression. You're merging from Route 3 West onto Route 46 West. You there with me? And you're waiting your turn. You're in line with all those cars. And you see out of your right side view mirror a car racing up the shoulder who decides to come in right in front of you. But instead of leaning on the horn and saying something that you're going to have to ask God's forgiveness for later, you just back off and you go, you know, maybe this guy, maybe he just found out his wife has cancer. Maybe his girlfriend just dumped him, or worse. You post something that's really important to your heart on social media, you put it out there, and someone responds not only disagreeing with you, but mocking you and belittling you to your social media post. But instead of jumping right in as you feel your heart rate rise, you feel your adrenaline pumping, instead of jumping into the fight to prove them wrong and get into the battle, you decide just to put your phone away or you close your laptop and you say, God, what are you trying to teach me through this? Let your gentleness be evident to all. And you know, the only way you can do that is if you do the second half of this verse, if you know that the Lord is near. Jesus modeled this incredibly. Look at 1 Peter 2:23. When they hurled their insults at him, that can kind of get you to want to get some revenge, right? When people hurl insults at you. He did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, here's what he did. He entrusted himself to him who judges justly. So the way that Jesus was able to hold back, to respond with gentleness and self-control, was because he knew that God could handle it. He didn't have to take matters into his own hands because he knew my Father's got this. And so I have to ask myself, when I get all stressed out, do I really believe that my Father is in control, that the Lord is near? Do you believe that? Because when we really believe that, we develop what I would call a powerful gentleness. You know, restraint, when you could go at it, restraint is a powerful act. Just being drawn into the battle and going at it, that's a weakness. That's just responding. Restraining is a powerful thing. Here's the third choice. Choose prayer. Choose prayer. Verse 6 is actually the first half of that most highlighted Kindle verse, right, in the Bible. So here's what it says. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. That verse 6 is like a mini course on prayer. I mean, there's so much in there. So let me just call out three quick things that it tells us about prayer. First, pray always. Pray always. It says, in every situation. There is not a situation in life where it's not good to pray. There does not exist a situation like that. If you think about it, this is how good relationships work, right? I mean, this is a big month for me, that later this month I'm married 32 years, and when I think about my marriage, and I think about, save it for a couple weeks, and when I think about other marriages of people that I know, thank you, they talk a lot. They find time to get on the phone. They find time to text each other. If you look at my text chains with my wife, you'd think we're still like in high school. We just like to keep in touch. We don't let more than a half a day or so go by before we're checking in with each other. Healthy relationships find time to get away together, to have lunch together, to talk, to communicate. Healthy relationships talk a lot, and healthy Christians pray a lot. That's just what you do when you're in a good relationship. Maybe you think, God's got bigger things to worry about than my stuff. God's dealing with the Middle East. I'm going to tell him about my stuff. Yes. Jesus taught all about that. Remember, he said, your heavenly Father knows how many hairs you have on your head. He knows every time a little sparrow falls to the ground and how much more valuable are you than a little bird. He cares about everything. He cares about your love life or your lack thereof. He cares about your finance, your financial problems. He cares about the concerns you have about your family. He cares about the fears and phobias that you have. Parents, like, you care about all the stuff in your kids' lives, right? Even though they find it annoying, you always ask about it. God cares about all the things in his kids' lives. So pray about that stuff. Every time you pray about it, it's another reminder. You know, I'm not alone in this. God actually cares. He's in this with me. hard for anxiety to compete with that. This verse also teaches us to pray specifically. It says, present your requests to God. Not like pray for a general blessing on your day, amen. Right? This is like the specific stuff, itemized, personal, individual requests to God. The specific things that you roll over in your mind when you can't get to sleep at night, that stuff. Talk to God about that. I find myself, as I'm getting older, more and more turning off the music in the car, because here's what I find myself doing. I'm driving along in the car, and I start thinking about stuff, and I tend to start thinking about the problems in my life, like the difficult things. Anybody else? Like, you know, I don't just drift to like all the blessings in my life. I start to think about hard things and some difficult confrontation I'm going to have with someone and whatever the difficult things are and how should I handle that. And I worry about stuff. And more as I get older, I find myself turning off the podcast or turning off the radio and just talking to God about it instead. Like, Lord, here's what I'm thinking about this situation. I got to talk to this guy. And I'm worried if I say this, he's going to say that. And Lord, help me with this. Like you'd talk to a friend, like specific stuff. Lord, give her wisdom as she makes this decision about whether to break up with this guy or stay with this guy. God, that's what I'm worried about. So I'm talking to you about it. Lord, he's been so tempted with this stuff for so many years. Give him supernatural self-control as he faces this temptation today. Specific things. Lay those things out to God. He cares about all of it. It matters to God when you pray about those things. God has all the time in the world, and he loves to hear from you. And then third, pray gratefully. Did you notice that? And notice it doesn't say, okay, when you pray for something, once you get what you asked for from God, make sure to say thank you for it. That's not what's laid out here. It says, when you're presenting your requests to God, do it with thanksgiving. Like before you even get an answer. Before you even know how it's going to work out, be grateful. How can you do that? Only if you're convinced that God knows way more than you do and that he loves you and he'll always do what's best, then you can be like, I'm going to thank you, Lord, no matter what happens. Thank you for that. I love the way Tim Keller said it, as usual. He said, God will either give us what we ask or give us what we would have asked if we knew everything he knows. I like that. So it's like, he'll do the right thing. And when I believe that, I can thank him even before I see what the answer is going to be. I think back in my life for some of the stuff that I've prayed for over the years. Like I prayed, that for success in my pre-med studies, that success never came because God had a different calling for me. I didn't get what I prayed for, and it's a good thing. There were certain girls that I wanted to date in college. I prayed they would say yes to me. Those yeses never came because God had somebody different for me. There are certain injuries I've had as a runner through my life. I've prayed would heal quickly. They healed slow. Some of them still haven't healed because God was teaching me patience and compassion for other people with problems and all kinds of things. So if I'm convinced, even though I'm going to pray for stuff, right, that I think that I want, I think that are good, but I can thank God that either he'll give me those things or he'll give me something better. And so, man, thank you, Lord, for that. So when you feel the anxiety rising up, choose to pray. Pray always. Pray specifically. Pray gratefully. There's no prison. Think about this. There is no prison in life that can stop you from praying. They can't make you stop, no matter what. Fourth choice that we can make is to choose beauty. Choose beauty. Look at verse 8. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, noble, right, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, or praiseworthy, think about that stuff. You have the power to choose what kinds of things will fill your mind. And Paul is saying, hey, use that autonomy, that choosing power, to fill your mind with things that are noble and right and pure and lovely. I've tried to wrap up all those adjectives with the word beauty, beautiful things. Choose to fill your mind with beautiful things. I recently mentioned in a message the Japanese-American artist Makoto Fujimura. When he and his wife were newly married, they moved to Connecticut. She was working on a master's degree, and he was really a starving artist at that point. So he was actually teaching in a special ed school. He was pursuing his art from his apartment, trying to do his painting. He said they had almost no money, and things were just really tight. So one night he was sitting alone in the apartment. He said that, you know, they had lived on tuna almost the whole week, cans of tuna fish to make ends meet. He didn't know how they were going to buy food the next week. And he was waiting for his wife to come home, and she walked in the door with this bouquet of flowers. And he said, I got angry. I said to her, how can you buy flowers? We don't even know if we can afford to buy food. And he said his wife's response to him has been burned into his heart for the 30 years since that happened. His wife said to him, you know, we need to feed our souls too. Guys, we need to feed our souls. And we get to choose whether to feed them worthless things or beautiful things. If you drive around all day listening to political talk radio, is it any wonder you feel angry and on edge all the time? Right? Like, if you spend hours a day on social media comparing yourself with everybody else's body, house, family, vacation, of course, can't you see your anxiety level goes up when you fill yourself with that? Choose to fill yourself with things that are noble and pure and good. The other night, Norma Jean and I had the night free, and we were trying to figure out something to watch on TV. And did you ever notice that there are thousands of things to watch on TV, but there's nothing to watch on TV sometimes? Like, nothing looks good. And so this night, I had found this on Amazon Prime. I'd found this this documentary movie called Mully. It was about this guy named Charles Mully, who grew up in Kenya. And when he was a teenager, he woke up one day and his family had abandoned him. They were just gone. They were so desperate that they went to find better opportunities. He made his way to Nairobi, to the capital. He found work doing, you know, some kind of menial work. Through his employer, he discovered the gospel and gave his life to Christ. After one amazing thing after another, he got better jobs. He wound up starting a taxi company in Kenya that grew to all over the country. And he became this fabulously rich guy. And he decided to use all of his wealth to start orphanages all over Kenya, which are these amazing places where kids live and they have self-sustaining farms and just these incredible things all over Kenya. Now it's spread outside of Kenya. So anyway, we watched this movie, this documentary, and we walked away going, like, I feel like our souls are a little bigger. It was a beautiful thing to fill our hearts with. I'll confess, there are other times we watch things on TV and we go, why did we even watch that? You ever feel like that? If you watch something, you're like, oh man, my soul feels like it's sort of shriveled up now a little bit. You have the power to decide what things to fill your mind with. Choose beauty. Listen, beauty is so much stronger than anxiety. And then one more choice that we can make is to choose action. Action. Verse 9, whatever you've learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice. When you feel anxiety coming on, one of the wisest things you can do is just put into practice the things that you know are right. In other words, don't just sit there and be a passive victim of anxiety. Get up and do something. I had the privilege when I first entered ministry in the mid-90s to mentor under one of the guys on the chapel staff. His name was Marsh Davis. And some of you, probably a few of you remember Marsh. He was our pastor of care for years. And I remember talking to Marsh one day about how he helps people who are struggling with depression. And he said, you know, one of the things I always tell them is to fight that tendency to just sit around and to stay in bed all day. And fight that tendency because it tends to breed more depression. So he would tell them to get up and do something constructive. Clean the garage, clean out the junk drawer, clean out the fridge, call somebody, go to the gym. And of course, that's not the whole solution for depression. It's complex, but it's an act of obedience to God, and it gets you moving in a good direction. If you're feeling anxiety now for any reason, maybe God's wisdom for you is as simple as taking action, like putting into practice the things you know are good and healthy and honoring to God. Sometimes that will seem like sheer choice of your will. Like, you don't wanna, you don't have energy. I was just talking to someone in the first service today. She lost her husband a few weeks ago. And there she was sitting in church by herself. And I said, it's so good to see you here. And she said, you know, I didn't wanna come today. But she said, I got up and I just made myself come. I knew I should be here. And she said, I'm so glad I came. Sometimes it's just a sheer act of the will to show up. God has given you the freedom to choose action. So choose. Choose joy, choose gentleness, choose prayer, choose beauty, choose action. If you make those five choices, all the anxiety in your life will instantly melt away, right? Nah, probably not. You know why? You know why I'm not going to set it up like that? Because the Bible's not a self-help manual. The Bible doesn't like lay out these formulas like if you do A and B, C will result. That peace is not this psychological state that you can work yourself into. It's just not. Because ultimately, even though those are five really good, wise choices to make, ultimately, peace is a relationship with a person. I mean, it's not a self-help technique. It's a relationship with a living person. And that's so important to remember. Making these five choices is one of the wisest things you can do. But as you make these choices, realize you're not creating peace. You are opening yourself up to God's peace to enter your life. The best analogy I can think of is sailing, right? You can put your boat out on the water. You can raise your sails. You can position your sails just right. But you're not going to go anywhere unless there's some what? There's got to be some wind, right? That's what makes things actually go. And just a side note, I think it's so cool that the Greek word for wind, pneuma, is the same exact Greek word for spirit, pneuma. Isn't that awesome? Because God's spirit, there's some unpredictability to it and there's power to it. It's kind of like the wind. So unless God's spirit shows up, you can do these five things perfectly, but there's not going to be any peace. It comes from God. But making those five choices says, yes, God, I'm raising my sails. I'm putting myself in the path of your power. I'm doing what I can. Now come and fill me with your peace. So verse 7 has this awesome promise. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. The peace of God. It's like the peace that originates with him. It's the peace you can only get from a relationship with him. And then verse 9, I love this, at the very end, says it from a different angle, and the God of peace will be with you. That's even better, right? God does not just like, here's some peace. God says, I'm going to give you myself, the God of peace. As Dietrich Bonhoeffer sat in a German prison for daring to defy Adolf Hitler, he wrote this poem. I'll read you the first few lines. In me there's darkness, but with you there's light. I am lonely, but you do not leave me. I am feeble in heart, but with you there is help. I am restless, here it is, but with you there is peace. The pressure on him was so intense, the level of stress, he needed more than just the peace of God. He needed the God of peace. He needed to know God himself was with him. Same thing for Paul. So much was out of his control, but he knew deep in his soul, the living God is actually with me in this prison. As we experience our own prisons, we need to know that. The God of peace, that's who will be with you. Peace is a person. And it's a peace that transcends all understanding. It doesn't make sense. It defies logic. It doesn't make sense that Rick Warren could return to loving his congregation and fighting hunger and poverty around the world and preaching the gospel after he lost his son. That transcends understanding. That doesn't add up. It doesn't make sense that Tony Dungy is now working as an NFL commentator and writing and speaking and loving his family after what happened to him. That transcends understanding. You would think that guys like that would just be ruined, right? They'd be in an alley drinking somewhere, but they're not. The fact that they're walking in peace instead of anxiety is testimony that our God is real. I realize you probably have some prisons in your life that are keeping you from making certain choices, right? Maybe there's certain things you used to be able to do when you were younger or when you were in certain life situations. You can't do those anymore. But here's what you need to know. Here's what I'm saying. The most important choices in life are wide open to you. There's nothing and no one that can stop you from choosing joy, from choosing gentleness. You can choose to pray. You can choose beauty, right? You can choose Everything that really matters the most in life, you can choose to take action of things that are right. So choose wisely, and the God of peace will be with you. And I want to close this service by reminding ourselves where that peace is.